hereby call the meeting to order. Peter, would you please call the roll?
Sure. Rickard?
Here.
Smith?
Here.
O'Grady?
Here.
Barbara here and Epstein.
Epstein here.
Michael, do you have some announcements?
Yeah, welcome to the district's regular board or special board meeting in December. This meeting is fed live over the internet, and the public can view this meeting by going to kmpud.com and following the appropriate link. If the public would like to make a comment or ask a question, please email msharp@kmpud.com and the board will respond. I'll ask that members of the public please identify yourselves when making a comment.
Great. Item four is comments from the audience. This is an opportunity for members of the public to address the board on any short non-agenda items that are within the subject matter jurisdiction of the district. No discussion or action can be taken on matters not listed on the agenda per the Brown Act. Any matters from the audience, the public? Moving on to item five, corrections to the agenda or consent calendar. Michael, do you have some corrections you'd like to request?
We do. District staff would like to pull forward the IRS payment and the Q&D construction payments that are in the consent. We'd like to bring those forward to agenda item number 7 for further discussion.
Okay, so to be clear, the consent calendar has item 6A, regular board minutes, 6B, employee manual, 6C, consent for claims, and you're pulling just two of the claims, not the full consent.
Yes.
And 6D, receivables shut off. So with that...
So we can approve the consent. I mean,
We should probably pull the full consent for claims.
Yeah, that's what I was going to say.
We can discuss that separately.
Great.
So with that, I would entertain a motion to adopt the consent calendar, excluding item 6C.
So move.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Item 7 is consent items brought forward for separate discussion and action.
Two items I'd like to discuss before the consent is approved. One is a bill from the IRS, which are penalties and interest in the amount of $5,225.46. Each pay period, the Internal Revenue Service requires that all federal, Social Security, and Medicare taxes be paid to the IRS within a specific amount of time after the pay date. We currently make our payments through Bank of the West through their tax direct services. The per pay period amounts are then totaled on Form 941, which is submitted on a quarterly basis to the IRS. Recently, we received a notice of penalties from the IRS due to some prior pay periods being submitted late. These were in 2012 and one in January of 2015. These were all special payroll periods, one to end the fiscal year and two at the end of calendar years. When a pay period payment is not submitted on time, a penalty fee and interest is added to that payment by the IRS. Should be noted that a couple of these were late in 2012 when we're just being notified of the penalty now. However, the interest on those amounts are pretty minimal. One is $96 and one is $217. Staff called and discussed the situation with an IRS representative. During that conversation, we learned that we're a semi-monthly scheduled depositor, and being a semi-monthly scheduled depositor means that all our pay period payments are due no later than the Wednesday following the payroll. So basically, staff was late on making payments back in 2012 and at the beginning of this year, and staff is committed to completing all pay period payments before the Wednesday deadline. Staff will be sure that the correct due date will be entered on the tax direct form, which is completed online each pay period, when tax payments are made. Staff will also be sure to correctly complete the Schedule B, which is then included with our 941 quarterly return. These actions above will stop all penalties and interest. So we were we actually did some things wrong in 2012 in the beginning of this year. I think we've contacted IRS, have a good feeling going forward, and I recommend approval of this penalties and interest payment. And I'll just go on to the second one if that's appropriate,
sure.
Unless there's discussion.
There might be some discussion, but why don't you go on to the second one?
Okay. Q&D final payment. The board will remember we omitted a certain amount of the final payment from Q&D because we had a reconciliation issue when we did the final $64,000 payment to Q&D. The Outbelly project was awarded as a quantities-based contract where the contractor bid on a unit-based method. As an example, the district estimated the number of square feet that would need to be paved, and the contractor bid per square foot. The contractor was then paid on the actual number of square feet paved in the bid amount. The reconciliation was handled through a change order process, if you remember. However, at the beginning of the project, RCA attempted to complete this reconciliation on the submittal of each pay request without a change order. At the request of the district, this practice was changed early in the project to a change order so that we could actually see them. But a change order of $18,211 for additional repaving was paid out, but not submitted as a change order. During our reconciliation, we found this. We've already actually paid that $18,211, but we pulled it from the final reconciliation because it wasn't shown as a change order. This is an administrative issue that's kind of already been passed, and we do recommend payment to Q&D for the $18,211 for the additional repaid work.
I'm not sure I understand that. We paid it or not?
Well, we paid it, but in the final reconciliation, see, there was the contract amount of $12 million, and then there was the change orders of $1.1 billion. We paid it and we thought it was part of the contract amount, but in fact it should have been included in the change orders because that's how we eventually was doing business, but that's not how RCI began with it. So we paid it in advance. Then when we came down to the final numbers, we said, no, you're overbilling us by $18,000 for the contract amount. They said, no, it was a reconciliation. It should have been a change order. So
okay.
That's how that.
So the cash is already out the door.
Right.
We're
actually taking money from the final contract amount, which they actually deserve.
So there's no payment. Right now there's no payment necessary. It's already
paid.
Yeah,
because we deducted it from
the
final payment
see.
Because we didn't reconcile, and now we've done the reconciliation.
I see.
And if you remember on the final payment that we did a few months ago, there was a discrepancy about between the final amount due and what we were paying.
Yeah.
This is the result of that reconciliation.
Okay, so we thought we paid a change order and we really paid the contract.
Right.
Now we're paying the change order.
Yes, sir.
Now on the first one, there's nothing we can do to reduce that amount. Is there anything we can do to reduce that amount?
I don't believe so. They were indeed paid late,
mm-hmm.
Each one. I think some of them could have been forgotten by previous staff members, just didn't pay the tax payment on time and then paid it. One was due in, I think it was August, and it actually got paid in October, so there was some delays in our payment of these back in 2012.
So what is the Bank of the West service?
It's a tax direct. It's a wire transfer service that we...
Oh, that's all it is they're not...
So they take it directly out of our checking or revenue account and pay it to the IRS.
Well, we have to tell them how much and when.
Right. And I transfer the funds, and it's supposed to be done by the Wednesday of the payroll, which is on Thursday. So we have like 5 days to get it done. And in one case, this was actually a couple of months. But we made a mistake.
And had we been paying it the same way for previous years, or what changed in 2012?
Yeah, With these three, the difference between these three is that they were special payrolls.
I see.
Where they were ending up a fiscal year, or and they didn't follow the normal pattern, so they did a special payroll, and we missed the tax payment.
Any questions or dealing with the IRS? You don't have a lot to, to deal with. Any comments, questions from the audience? Kelly?
I just want to say that we did spend several hours on the phone with the IRS to make sure that we understood the schedule and the dates and when things were due and how to handle special payrolls. So Kim and I both have a very good handle on what the rules are and to be sure that from now on that this doesn't happen.
Thank you. Nancy?
So since this goes back to 2012, is that correct? So will this have any impact on the completed audits?
We can ask Olga. I don't believe so, but we certainly can ask our auditor.
Yeah, I don't know. Any further questions or comments? If you could let us know, or at least the Finance Committee, well, all of us, including Nancy. I guess I make a motion to approve these two payments.
Well, we're approving all of them.
The full consent.
Yeah, consent.
Right,
the payments.
Yes, submitted. Yes. I'd second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. So it passes unanimously. Item 8A is Certificate of Appointment and Oath of Office of Standish O'Grady Mead and Jeff Smith for the Board of Director positions commencing December 4, 2015 and ending December 6, 2019. Manager Sharp.
So congratulations. I think that I have a certificate of appointment to hand to you and the oath of office would be next. So if you please rise and raise your right hand. I state your name.
I, Jeffrey Smith.
I, Standish O'Grady.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
Do solemnly swear or affirm.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support and defend the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
And the Constitution of the State of California.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
Against all enemies, foreign and domestic.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
That I will bear true faith and allegiance.
To the Constitution of the United States and the Constitution of the State of California.
To the Constitution of the United States and to the Constitution of the State of California.
To the Constitution of the United States and to the Constitution of the State of California.
That I take the obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
That I take the obligation freely without any mental reservation or hesitation.
Purpose of evasion.
Could you repeat it, please?
That I take the obligation freely.
That I take the obligation freely.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
Without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
And that I will well and faithfully discharge.
That I will well and faithfully discharge
the duty upon which I am about to enter.
The duties upon which I am about to enter.
The duty upon which I am about to enter.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
We'll have an official signing at the end of the meeting, but here's your certificate.
I had to think twice about that without reservation. B is election of board officers, president, vice president, secretary, treasurer, and assistant secretary. I would like to propose for consideration for making a motion that we consider for President Bob Epstein, consider for Secretary Peter Dornbrook, consider for Vice President Eric Rickert, and we consider for Assistant Secretary Jeff Smith. Finally, we consider for Treasury me, Standish O'Grady. So I would open that up to discussion.
Sounds good. Sounds like everybody's addressing their skill set to the most effective role, I'd say.
Any comments from the audience or discussion? You don't get to make a recommendation here.
No.
Then I'll turn that into a motion.
The only reservation I have is after 2 years, we're finally getting to get the meetings done quickly. I don't know if we want to jump in. Okay.
That's very nice of you, Peter. I would say that there's a balance between full discussion and time of the meeting, and I'm sure our new president will improve on that. So I'd like to make a motion that we elect Bob Epstein as president, Peter Dornbrook as secretary, Eric Rickert as vice president, Jeff Smith as assistant secretary, myself as treasurer.
Second that motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Yes, congratulations, Bob.
I just want to add that Peter holds the record as president as doing it for 25 years, and that's probably a record that will never
probably
be.
Too long.
I wouldn't say that, but it'll probably never be broken. So thank you very much. And so we'll now move on to item 8C, annual review and possible changes to the board and committee member positions on the district's committees and possible changes to policy number 140. Committees and related chapters. So, Michael.
Hi, I have a slide in the packet as well as on the screen here of the existing committee appointments for the board members. I can make a recommendation on this one. And I recommend the following change. This would be the finance would be Standish O'Grady and Eric Rickert. Operations capital would be Peter Dornbrook as chair and Jeff Smith. Planning would be Eric Rickert as chair and Jeff Smith. Personnel would be Bob Epstein as chair and Standish O'Grady for the board's review.
Okay, is there any discussion?
Sounds like a good lineup to me. And I'm actually, with this snow, I'm already optimistic that there's going to be more capital projects to consider, so I think Peter chairing one committee and it will become more like two.
You think we're going to have more cash to spend?
Absolutely.
All right.
I can feel
it. That's a positive thought.
Okay, is there any comments from the audience? Okay, hearing none, is there a motion to approve the committee members as proposed?
I make that motion to approve the committee members.
All right, Standish makes the motion. Is there a second?
Sure.
Jeff seconds. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Okay, so we've established the committee. Michael, next.
So the community members,
right.
I don't recommend any changes to that, except I've discussed it with Casey Bland, and believe that he'll be removing himself from the finance committee. I do recommend that the board, by motion, I haven't gotten this officially from Mark and Alan, but I do anticipate that they will want to continue their involvement with the Finance Committee. So I would recommend that that they be reinstated for another term. Their terms both end in December 2016. And that's the only changes that I have on the community member.
Did you say their terms end?
In the end of December 2015.
Okay, this year.
Right, this year.
And then we need to go hopefully find someone to take Jeff's community place on the planning. Well, I'm certainly happy to move that we have Mark and Alan continue if they so choose.
Okay. Any other discussion? Any comments from the audience? All right. Is there a motion to approve the Finance Committee community members?
So moved.
Okay.
Second.
Seconded by Eric. Okay. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Okay. It passes unanimously. Okay. The next item.
I do have a question. Oh, okay. Let's see. Do other committee members' terms end at the same time now, or is it staggered? I can't remember what we did.
That's actually my next topic.
Oh, got it.
So, Ian, can I just...
Why don't we move on? It's all related to discussion of policy number 140, which establishes us. Go ahead, Michael.
So, policy 140 calls for the member terms to be established by charter, but recommends a rotating basis. And the charters actually call for a rotating 3-year membership so that there's continuity. And so it would be 1 year, 2 year, and 3 years. And each year, one of the members is reappointed or re-upped. This actually hasn't worked in actual practice. And I have several changes that I'd like to make to policy statement 140 and the committee charters. One is to do with the provision for rotating terms. This has not been, workable for the district, and it seems like they're all coming up at once or different times, and we don't actually rotate through. People seem to work many, many terms through. So we'd like to change that. We'd also like to put in the district's preference to have community members only serve on one district committee instead of several, and that would be an exception would be the wine tasting committee, because we have several committee members that work on that. But for regular standing committees, finance, planning, operations, capital, we'd like community members to serve on just one. And then the last item is that there's a provision for minutes to be maintained in each of and replace that with actual practice that we have actual action items. So all of these changes make the policy statement and charters adhere to our current district practice. Staff will bring these changes back before the board at the next meeting, and we'll circulate copies of what we're intended to do. But you'll have an opportunity to take a look at this before enacting that.
I think it's a good idea to conform to our actual practice. When it comes to community members, when I'm looking at whatever you're going to propose, it's always this balance between you want enough people on the committees so they can function well and we can get that input on the one hand, but on the other hand, we want some rotation so that more and more community members become involved with the district. So how we find that balance, I'm not sure. It's important.
Okay, there are other comments? Nancy?
So, I'm a member of the Planning Committee. Didn't realize there was going to be an opening on the Finance Committee, but, there's no decision that has to be made right now, but if, I'd be willing to step aside from Planning to join Finance, that would work for people, since I do participate in those.
What would you be more interested in or most interested in?
Probably Finance. Not that I haven't enjoyed my time on Planning.
I hear the new chair is really good, too.
Should we make a decision now, or should
sure.
we?
Sure.
Is Casey, we would elect Nancy when Casey's term expires, I think.
Yes, she could attend. She'd be attending the next January. The next meeting would be in January. And staff has no issue with seeing that change. We want to promote where Nancy wants to serve. So.
Sure.
May I just request as the chair of the plan committee. And this leaves us.
Want to fight for it?
Scarce resources.
Just temporarily. I would really like to get at least some names of planning, possible planning people. It just leaves us with one community member. That's all, Cheryl.
That's true.
And Cheryl's great, but it'd be nice to have a little bit more breadth of perspectives and so on, and Nancy provides that certainly in the planning. So I'm just suggesting that we wait 1 month.
Sure.
If we could.
Well, I would prefer to do that too, because I discussed with Michael Casey's preliminary indication of wanting to get off, and I think we discussed that it might be appropriate to talk to him about whether Vail had another representative. I guess we could broaden it to say interested in either finance or planning.
Yeah, actually, that's good. I mean, as I thought, because I knew we had this vacancy on the planning, and I was thinking that since Vail is our biggest customer, you know, their thoughts on our strategies as far as infrastructure goes would be a good perspective to have. So if it could be at least open it up to that, that would be great.
And along those same lines, Nate Whaley has expressed interest to be on planning as well.
Well, I should bring Bob Endy back then.
Well, Bob Endy isn't gone.
Not completely. Yeah.
So he might still be on planning.
Okay, so if we could just wait for a month to shake this out and then hopefully be able to give people their preferences.
And so you'll also ask, talk to Casey about whether they would be interested in supplying a member from one or both?
Yes.
And Michael, how do we let the community know that we're soliciting, you know, letters of interest on this?
It happens in through newsletter publications and then through my contact quite often. If I see a board member or a member of the community that would just be perfect to help us along, I actually reach out and contact them.
Okay, so we'll plan on putting that in the December newsletter in time, so try to encourage interest in the openings.
Would it be worth sending out an email to the email list before the holidays saying, you know, we have openings here. If anybody's interested, it might be worth discussing it either with you or with Bob or with the head of the committees. I mean, a lot of people up here, people tend to focus on Kirkwood during the holidays.
Sure. I actually think that's better. Okay, so Michael and I will take on that. I think that concludes 8C. We are 2 minutes ahead of schedule. Sorry about that. Won't happen again.
It's a quick learn.
So if you would call that number, please, and okay. I can go ahead and open up that moment time.
Right.
Welcome to the conference call. Please input your access code followed by the pound key. At the tone, please record your name for announcement to the call organizer and then press the pound key to enter your conference.
Kirkwood Meadows Public Utility District.
You will now enter the conference. The subscriber has not yet arrived at the conference call. If you are the subscriber, please press the star key now. Please enter your subscriber PIN, followed by the pound sign.
We'll take a 2 minute interlude for music and then continue. No, we've upgraded or downgraded. It depends on your age, I guess.
Olga, is that you?
Are you on?
I'm still on.
Oh, you're on?
Perfect.
Scroll here.
So do you want us to wait, or should we?
I can do an introduction.
Okay.
So at the last meeting, the board asked for a presentation by Moss Adams to better describe the changes in the financial statements due to the GASB 68 and the reporting of the district's unfunded pension liability. And Olga Darlington with Moss Adams will be here today shortly. I talked to her this morning, so she should be calling in momentarily to give that presentation. I told Olga it'd be around 15 minutes or so. In your packet is actually the presentation, plus it'll be up on the board.
Olga Darlington has arrived.
Perfect time. Hi, Olga.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. This is Bob Epstein. You're right on time, and we are ready for you to
Perfect.
Start.
Fantastic. Okay, well, thank you very much for letting me explain to you this or help understand this complex standard. Do we have the slides up? Is somebody operating the machinery for me?
We do. We have our operator standing by and ready.
Excellent. Okay. All right. So what I want to do with the slide deck, there's a few slides. It's a very brief overview of the standard, and I'm going to go through it rather quickly to just kind of give you highlights rather than just getting buried in the very details of a very complex standard. But hopefully this will provide a nice overview to kind of to understand what's happening in the financial statements of the district. So starting with the second slide that kind of summarizes the overview, I think the main thing I want to point out here is that what really the standard has changed is where historically the pensions were reported in the financial statements of entities based on funding method. So there was a complex actuarial calculation, and based on what funding needed to be provided to the plan, that's how the accounting was maintained as well. And when I say accounting maintained, the liabilities were, or assets sometimes, were never really recorded on the balance sheets of any entity. All of the information was disclosed in the financial, in the footnotes to the financial statements. So what this standard has done is separated the accounting reporting for pensions from the funding-based reporting that was done before. So nothing really changed from a standpoint of how the decisions are made on how the plans need to be funded. It's strictly more of a mechanical accounting procedure now to comply with accounting standards as far as the reporting pension liabilities on the balance sheet versus just in the footnotes. So it certainly modifies the look and feel of the financial statements themselves. So if we go to the next slide, this is kind of a very simplified version of how the pension liability is calculated. I kind of downsized it to the three-step process. So if we look at the lifespan of the employees that we currently have, let's assume they start in the workforce at age 25 and the employee retires at 62 and then lives to receive benefits past 80. The way the standard requires to is estimate the liability for the pension for this employee is to project the benefit that the employee will be receiving from the retirement date, and in this example it's assumed to be 62, and through the remaining lifespan of the employee. So that estimate is calculated first. Then that estimated liability is discounted back to however old employees today. In this case, it's 25. We're discounting it all the way back. And then we have to apportion that liability over the working life of this employee. So that's what's happening in the attribution step, allocating that liability as employees earning it over its working life, working from age 25 to 62. So kind of an easy three-step process. What makes it complex, if we go to the next slide, is measuring that the different assumptions that going into measuring the liability and discount rates, discounting the liability back to current times, and then attribution. And specifically, I don't want to go in detail in these unless you have questions later on. I can certainly address those. But it is so sensitive, some of these assumptions, that, for example, for discount rates, the standard requires to put in the financial, in the footnotes to the financial statement, a sensitivity analysis. A 1% change in the discount rate, how would it change a liability? So if it was, if it, let's say discount per, rate is 7%, if it was 6%, what would be the liability? If it was 8%, what would be the liability? So that's now kind of required disclosure in the financial statements, because a slight change in the discount rate, we've seen a really big swing in what that liability may be. So, and like I say, there's a whole host of different assumptions that go into calculating the liability, discounting it back, assuming the return on investments within the plan, and so forth. So all of that information is what makes the standard so complex. So when we go to the next slide, the net pension liability is what we are reporting on the financial statements now. And the way it's calculated is the plan takes total investments or total assets in the plan. From those total assets, the total liability for the benefits is subtracted, and the difference is that net pension liability. So in some plans where there is enough assets to cover entire liability, there is actually a net pension asset. I have a few clients who actually end up with a net pension asset because the investments in a pension plan are exceeding the expected benefits to be paid out. But for many of my clients, it's the net pension liability because investments at this point in time are not covering the expected liabilities over lifetime. So there is three different dates to consider when calculating the net pension liability, and this is what I want to highlight. So we reported a liability in the current year as of the current year end, which is June 30th, 2015. Well, in order for that number to be calculated, actuaries had to do a lot of work. A lot of those calculations had to be done. So the standard allowed us to use actuarial valuation 12 months, dated 12 months back. So we actually used June 30th, 2014 data to record the liability this year. In order for the actuary to do their calculations as of 6/30/14, they had to take census data on from the, all of the employers participating in the plan for the last another 12 months. So really, we're recording liability today for 6/30 year end based on the census information, essentially, who are all of the participants in the plan, what benefits they're eligible for, and so forth, based on 6/30/13 data, so 2 years back. So all of these dates had to be incorporated kind of in assumptions of calculating the liability, and all of that timing had to be incorporated as we were recording a liability in the current year. And when I say we, if we go to the next slide, the information for recording the liability was actually provided to management by the state. So CalPERS engaged the actuaries who have done the actuarial work on all of the participants in the plan, and they provided schedules to management at the district to record the liability that they needed to have on a balance sheet. Well, what does that mean? That means that CalPERS had to implement the standard first, perform all of this work in time to release it to all of the participants in the plan. There's thousands of employers in the state of California who are waiting for this information. And you may have heard that this was one of the reasons that the financial issuance was delayed this year, is because we were waiting for CalPERS to provide that information for us. And because of this is first year implementation, it did take a little bit longer to get all of the information to participating employers and to get it all calculated. So we received it this year in September. they are promising in future years to make that information available to employers in April and May timeframe. But at the end of the day, we are going to be relying on CalPERS every year to provide the information for management to report the liability, because they have all the records. They do the calculation at the plan level, and then just apportion a share of that liability, of the total plan liability, to each employer participating in the plan. So next couple of slides is just, so this is the some of the concerns that our cost-sharing plan or employers had in the past. The next couple of slides describe that liability or the responsibilities of the plan versus the employer responsibility. So just because the plan calculates the amounts and provides the information to the management doesn't mean management can just sit back and wait for the information to come to them. I mean, they have to receive the information, but once it's received, management has the responsibility to evaluate the information, make sure it's correct, read the reports that are provided from CalPERS. And the other responsibility, if we move to the next slide, 8, is to make sure that we, management, provide the correct census information to the plan, because whomever employees we have today, their age, their salary, their benefits that they're going to be receiving and so forth, will determine how much of a liability will be calculated by the plan going forward. So these are just some of the things that we worked through with management this year in adopting the plan and kind of looking forward as to what accounting will be needed. Now, when we look at the financial statements, and I keep talking about a liability, it's not just the one line item on the financial statement that's going to be new this current year. So you probably have seen the net pension liability, which was reported as of 6/30/15. It's in the amount of $382,000, roughly, reported as a non-current liability. There's two other areas in the financials that were impacted, and they're called deferred outflows of resources. That section is in the assets section of the balance sheet, and then deferred inflows of resources. That section follows the liabilities on the balance sheet. Those two amounts are really truly change in assumptions. So as the plan changes in the cost sharing plan, there's many different employers participating. They're all pulling funds together to invest to provide a better return on the assets. And then so each employer in the cost sharing plan is getting their little apportionment of the total liability. As employers change, as their participation percentages change, so does the participation percentage and the liability percentages that each employer may have. So those changes impact deferred inflows and outflows. Changing in benefits potentially may have impact on deferred inflows and outflows. Changes in investment rates, assumptions on investment return, and so forth. So there's those two areas. I want to say they're not very easy to understand from a standpoint of there is an assets or a liability. These are just kind of estimates of changes in assumptions as balances are calculated for the liability during the plan year. So you're going to see a couple of new balances on the balance sheet, and then all of the cumulative effect of all of those changes will be recorded as the pension expense on the income statement or on the statement of changes in that position. So that's the complexity of the standards, not just affecting one line item, but really going through different accounts and the financial statements affecting the look and feel of them. So we've added all of those new line items in the financial statements, and hopefully it clarifies a little bit what we have done with those statements. So that's kind of a very quick, very, very quick way of describing a very complex standard. So I do want to pause and allow you to ask questions and clarify anything else that I can.
Okay, Standish, you want to go ahead?
Olga, thanks for that clear explanation. I'm looking at the balance sheet, and there's a $382,000 net pension liability, as you mentioned. that's new this year.
Right.
It wasn't there last year. There's 190,000 deferred inflows of resources that is a liability that's there this year and not last year. So that's $572,000 of found liabilities. And there's a new asset of $280,000. So if I subtract the $280,000 from the $572,000, there's a $292,000 expense. Is there a non-cash expense or loss that flowed through the income statement this year?
It is. There is an expense, and I think, let me look at the statements very quickly. It is included in, we didn't call it out, I think, separately as a standalone line item. I think it's included in, we did. It is net pension expense or credit of $172,000. You'll see that new line item on page 18 of the financials.
Okay, but not page 11, which is the income statement, right? Okay, so this is...
So page 11, let me get there. Page 11 is statement of activities. It is a format of government reporting. So it's in the statement. It's actually... it's not hidden. It's included in the business type activity expenses that kind of spread through different funds, because what we have done is we allocated the total liability to individual enterprise funds. So the total expenses of business type activities on this statement is it's apportioned in each one of those line items just because it's presented differently here.
Okay, well, I guess a follow-up question is whether it would be possible in future years to have this as like a non-operating expense netted out as a net pension liability adjustment. And I can see why it's going to fluctuate from year to year based on changes in assumptions, changes in census data, and so forth. But from a external recipient's viewpoint, burying these kinds of expenses in operations, which is they're not operations, is misleading. Do you understand
what I'm driving at? I do see what you're saying, but at the same time, well, they're not really non-operating because they are. It's a pension. It's a benefit that your employees are earning right now that will be entitled. They will be entitled to upon retirement. So, if you look at them as any other employee benefits, they're really operating expenses because it's not. It's really tied to your employees performing their services and earning those benefits today.
So you're saying it's no different than vacation accrual?
Exactly. Or health benefits or OPEB or anything else. They don't get those benefits until much further in the future when they retire, but they are earning them now, so they're entitled to those benefits now. So it is technically an operating expense.
Okay, let me see if there's other questions from the board.
If I could just get an example of a deferred outflow and a deferred inflow, that might help me.
Did you hear the question?
An example where they are in the financial statements?
No, I see them on the financial statement. I just don't know what a deferred outflow is and why it's an asset.
The definition of a deferred outflow and a deferred inflow is strictly a governmental accounting standards definition. So it's anything that's not truly an asset and anything that's not truly a liability. It's just something, it's a new thing that they came up with. In this case, so for example, the biggest portion of deferred outflows of resources, for example, contributions, $278,000 in the current year. If you remember, I mentioned the different dates for calculating the liabilities. So the liability was calculated based on actuarial evaluation that was done as of 6/30/2014. Well, the district paid, or employees in the district made contributions to the plan subsequent to that date upon which the liability was calculated. So all of those contributions for fiscal year 2015, technically, according to the standard, that they get deferred in a way, can talk to the balance sheet, and in the next actuarial evaluation that the plan does as of 6/30/2015, these contributions will be incorporated as part of contributions made to the plan, and they will be reversed from the deferred outflow. So it's one of those things that will be changing every year.
Okay, that's a good example. Thank
now,
you. No, that actually is all I need. That's a good example. I appreciate that. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Perfect.
Okay, Nancy, I have a question.
So is, if an employee were to come today and start work today, spend 12 months here, and then leave, you'd still have that, you'd still be responsible, they'd be entitled to those benefits? I thought you had to vest.
You have to, the vetting means that they work for 5 years, and then they're eligible for the employer contributions that have been made on their behalf.
Oh, I see.
But the contributions that the employee makes,
right.
They're entitled to right away.
So I guess my question to Olga is, so how does that, if an employee hasn't vested, so how does that impact the financial statements?
Did you hear the question?
I didn't quite. I heard parts of it, but if you don't mind repeating it.
So the question is, if we have an employee that is employed here, let's say for 12 months, but hasn't vested, how would that show up on the financial statements?
Let me look at the footnote. I don't believe this plan has the vesting. This is the pension plan where it's a defined benefit plan. So they're entitled to their pension benefits as soon as they enter the plan. So the employee may be employed for a certain, let's say the employee stays employed for 5 years and then they leave the district, they go work for a private company, for a construction company. So they're technically out of government, the CalPERS. They're still entitled to some benefits based on their 5 years of employment with a government entity, with a district in this case. So the employee never really loses those benefits even if they choose to leave the plan. So the plan would still be, upon their retirement, they would still have, be eligible for a small portion of the benefit from the CalPERS. So yes, the district would still be responsible for that.
From the employer's side.
And that's from the employer's side?
Right, exactly. Well, at some point, so what happens is, one thing I didn't cover in here, when we're calculating the liability, we're calculating liability on active employees that you have right now, on inactive employees that have been employed at one point or another but then left the district, and on retired employees that are already retired, receiving benefits, but the plan may still be paying them out for a while. So those are three different groups, if you will, of participants in a plan, from the employee standpoint, that will be receiving benefits. And yes, so when the total liability is calculated, all of those groups of employees are taken into account, and yes, each employer will be responsible for their portion of however many of those participants are.
Okay.
Retired, inactive, and active.
Mm-hmm. So let me just ask you a question, not on how it's accounting, but just the overall management. So having a $382,000 pension liability, or is that, I realize we're disclosing, is that a problem, or is that within range? How should we think about the shortfall?
Well, I think you, as a participant in a cost-sharing plan, so remember I said cost-sharing plans, bunch of employees pool funds together to invest, and then the total liability calculated at the plan level, and you as a district receive your portion of a liability based on your percentage of participation. So that percentage is actually enclosed in the footnotes. It's like 0.00997. So it's very small. So you as an employer don't really have any control over changing that amount, because it's strictly based on how many participants are in the plan and what is your share, and how the funds are being invested, which of course is being done at the plan level. So I would say, from just looking at you know, some of the other clients that I have, that is not an unreasonable amount. That is not a large amount, actually, at all. I have clients, and it depends. It depends on how many employees, of course, you have. The district is a small entity with a small number of employees, and it's a reasonable amount for the liability. I have employers that have, you know, millions and millions and millions of dollars in the pension liabilities sitting on their balance sheets now. So I would say it's definitely not anything that you worry about. It's going to be very common in every government's financial statements as far as the pension liability, and it's just going to be a new item.
Okay, and Michael, you had a question?
And I agree with Olga that we have this unfunded pension liability, but we also have a portion of as a side fund that we do have control of and we can pay down, as we discussed in Finance Committee, which is our highest, most expensive debt. So just to keep that on the radar, that side fund could be paid down.
Good. Unless there's another question, I'm going to wrap this section up. Olga, thank you very much for taking time this afternoon to talk to us.
Absolutely. And I think on the very last slide, I have my contact information. So if any further questions come up or anything else, do give me a call and I'll be happy to talk about it more.
Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Goodbye.
Bye, Olga.
Okay. Why don't we move on next to 8E, discussion and possible action regarding the district's financials. And I welcome Kelly McBride to the hot seat.
Okay. So we'll get started with the October financials on page 57 of your packet. We'll start with the balance sheet. Just a few notes on the balance sheet for October of 2015. Again, the note regarding total reserve and total trustee special construction. Both of these will remain up from budget until we do receive that final payout or invoice from PG&E to pay that final invoice from PG&E. Those will remain above budget. Moving down to total accounts receivable, AR is up due to accrued property taxes of $284,000 and snow removal contract AR of $110,000. Moving down to total accrued interest payable, I just want to make a note that the budget number there is extremely higher than what it actually should be. I went back and checked the actual budget formula, and there is a bad formula in that cell. It didn't take into account the payment that we just made in September, so it didn't subtract the payment amount, so that number is much higher than what it actually should be due to that formula error. And then also just a note, Eric had mentioned the net pension liability was showing under the current liabilities, and we move that down now to the non-current liabilities where it belongs. That's all I have as notes on the balance sheet, unless there are any questions.
Well, so we didn't budget for any of these three new GASB 68 categories.
No.
How are you accruing for? Is it just like a prorated version of last 1/12 of last year?
We haven't accrued for anything yet. This is something that's going to happen.
These are resulting adjustments
from the audit, right? And it'll happen once a year. And they're going to, Moss Adams is going to provide me with spreadsheets and to work through what the new balances should be at the end of this fiscal year. So they will be helping me to calculate all of those things for next year. But it is a once-a-year change, so you won't see a change in those numbers until the end of this fiscal year.
Right. So taking that and what we just heard, I know what Olga said, they're operating expenses because they're related to your employees, but they are definitely not a good way for us to evaluate management, meaning in terms of cost containment and all that sort of stuff, and revenue attainment. So I think what we're left with is when we evaluate general manager's performance and staff performance, we're going to have to do it from the unaudited statements because we have absolutely no control over these actuarial assumptions that are being run through our income statement for audit purposes. I mean, does anybody disagree with that?
I agree completely.
Yeah. I mean, the government is really screwing up our ability to manage our business.
Right.
Just a note, though, too, that this year the expense was actually a credit to expense this year. So that was one good thing. It was a credit against our expenses for this year. Not to say it's going to stay that way, but
actually reduced our
pension. It did reduce our expense, our pension expense. So.
In that case, I like it.
Yeah, I was going to. It's kind of a year-by-year thing.
Yeah.
See, it reduced what we had not on the balance sheet in the footnotes last year, right?
It actually reduced our payments.
Okay.
Yeah.
Because we went to a payment per month schedule rather than a percentage of payroll, and they reevaluated our percentage of the pool, and we were actually reduced. So we have a net savings of, I think, approximately $28,000 for the entire year. Due to the GASB 68 as an expense item.
Right, but it wasn't due to superior management on our part. It was a gift from the actuaries. So, assuming
you can,
that...
You can judge me however you like.
So, we need...
I think we decided.
Yeah, if these are material numbers, we need some sort of pro forma to evaluate based on what we actually can control. Okay. Good, why don't we keep going?
Okay. Moving on to the combined income statement, a few notes regarding the variance in commercial and residential revenue. This is something that happens every year through the summer. You'll notice that the variance, they net out to just about a negative 4%, and these will come more into line as we go through the winter months with more commercial revenue. A note regarding our overall savings in operating expenses, that even without the savings that we're reporting for our depreciation, we would be very close to being right on budget for this year in operating expenses, which I think is a very good thing and should be noted.
Can I just ask a quick question on
sure.
the depreciation line? I remember all throughout last year, I think we were showing a more positive income statement bottom line than budget, but it was only because of a delay in timing of putting certain assets on the books, mm-hmm. right? How far through that process are we, and how much? Like this year, I mean, this month, $161,000 depreciation versus a budget of $194,000, $643,000 total this year versus $778,000. How much of that is simply because assets haven't landed on the books yet because we haven't paid the PG&E invoice or whatever? Or is it just the PG&E invoice? Is that it?
That's the biggest savings. And I think there's also some discrepancy in the budget compared to what is actually being depreciated. I think that when we go through the budget for next year, there's some savings that's occurring in wastewater that I think is just a budgeting number issue. It just wasn't as granular as it should be.
And the PG&E payment is that what term of depreciation is that? 30, 35, 20 years?
It depends on the... how it's applied to the two portions of the Out Valley.
Okay, it depends is a good enough answer.
Yeah,
there's different sections of RUS standards as far as transportation or transmission line, if it's a distribution line, or what the money was used to. And so it's categorized within our RUS loan, and we have RUS requirements of depreciation, just like we did on the powerhouse when we had that reduced. So it was a required depreciation.
And when we get that that invoice, I'm going to reach out again to Bob, who is our consultant for all of our Russ assets, to make sure that it's being depreciated properly and at the right length of time. Moving down, just that continuing note regarding contribution revenues, that is the TC Townhomes infrastructure. And again, that does flow through fire, water, wastewater, propane, and electric. And are there any questions, other questions on the combined income statement? Moving on to the separate funds, a few notes in G&A, salaries and wages, again, are up due to the movement of the fire barbecue wages, as well as the vacation payouts for those employees that left. Those were not obviously budgeted for to be paid out in a lump sum, and so those contributed to the overage in salaries and wages. And then also with payroll taxes and benefits, again, with the new way we are paying our side fund or unfunded liability with CalPERS, there is an amount of $3,836 that is posted now directly to G&A, where in the past that would have flown through all of the other departments based on the hours those employees worked in each of those departments. So it's something now that we can budget for next year, knowing that that's going to get posted directly to G&A rather than being blown through all the other departments. Moving on to fire department, you'll notice that there is a large savings right now in the fire department, mainly due to not spending in operations maintenance. That is something that I think is going to change. Rick let me know that there are some expenses coming through, but through the summer months, we did save some money in the fire department.
Thank you.
Moving on to the water fund. Again, just to note that salaries and wages and benefits and taxes are up due to the special projects we did over the summer with painting and changing water meters and installing new meters, things like that. In wastewater, year-to-date revenues are down, mainly in commercial revenue, just not as much commercial revenue.
Hey, Kelly, I mean, the reason it's such a glowing net income advantage versus budget is because of the townhomes, the allocation from the townhomes.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Oh, it just drives me nuts.
The wonderful rules and regulations that we have to follow. Moving down on wastewater to internal allocations, again, we've mentioned that the electric allocation is what's causing that overage in internal allocations. Moving on to employee housing, you'll notice that we are down in revenue, and that was due to the fact we have had a couple of unrented units in employee housing. We had one employee move out, and we've had one empty unit for quite a few months. So I think there's efforts being made to rent those out.
Okay. We only rent those to our employees. I think that was a question Nancy mm-hmm. asked in an email I saw.
And we can rent to
others, other employees,
as long as they're employees of the valley.
Yeah,
we can't ski lease them out or anything.
Sure.
Yeah,
we are considering
Airbnb
opening those up to other employees in the area.
But no, we just don't want that we're in any way short on staff that we'd really like to have up here.
Well, we need to have a reserve for snow removal staff. We brought back one temporary snow removal operator for these storms, and we have a budget to bring back two more, but we probably have to house those as well. And then if you have an exceptional year, like 2010-11, you need even more than what you budgeted for, and typically need the help. So it's been a juggling act, especially the last 4 years, where you want to have the housing for snow removal staff, but if you don't get the snow, it sits empty, and you end up with a negative variance.
Moving on to the electricity fund, cost of goods in electric is up directly due to increased diesel fuel costs for the Butte Fire and just the PG&E outage for their maintenance that they requested. And then also, that note on depreciation regarding the remaining PG&E Out Valley expense to be capitalized.
I forget what the answer is and why we put cost of goods sold into operating expenses as opposed to have a gross margin where you subtract cost of goods sold from revenue. Is it a PCS limitation?
No, that we previously had it above the line. It was a request from the board to move it down to cost of goods sold.
We used to not have a cost of goods sold item, right?
Right.
Yeah. Although it could still be improved further.
Right.
So I think I understand what you're saying. So it would be a separate category, not in operating expenses and not in revenues, but a cost of goods sold, and then have a net behind that, and then start your operating expenses.
Right.
Right. I've seen that as well. So we could look at PCS and see if they have that capability.
As I dust off my treasurer capabilities, maybe I'll come see you.
Oh, great.
Not next week, the week after.
Okay.
Is there any, I know it was talked about briefly once, possible recovery of costs from PG&E if they were their line was the cause of the fire?
Yeah, and that was discussed at the Finance Committee as well. Staff would be looking into that. There has been a lawsuit. I don't know where that's gone. But that was the suggestion from the Finance Committee.
Is that a lawsuit that the district should join?
We're talking about $22,000 to $30,000. I don't know. I have reservations on joining a lawsuit with PG&E at this point.
Okay, moving on to the propane fund. You'll see that dramatic savings in cost of goods sold for propane is due to the extremely low cost of propane. We budget for a much higher cost and of $1.96 a gallon. It was running between 50 and 60 cents a gallon. Recently, in the last month, it's come up to about 90 cents a gallon. But even still, that's still a dramatic savings against what we actually budget for. And then also, you'll notice the savings in salaries and wages in propane. And this is, again, due to employees working in the other funds for those special projects over the summer. They're not working in propane, they're working in water and wastewater, helping out with those types of things. So.
But Kelly, the lower revenues in propane are due to the fact that we're not collecting money for the higher. So it isn't necessarily that the usage is down.
I think that the usage is down a little bit, but...
But not 20%.
Right.
So we come back to the same sort of question is, so the financial, some of it we have no control over how they're done, but if you just want to know, are we doing okay or not, it requires a fair amount of detailed knowledge to reverse items, add other items, to come up with an answer. And although they're much better than they were, there's still the question, is there a way of doing this that you could just know, are we okay or not? And be able to figure that out.
And it doesn't help when you have mandated postings like the timber improvements.
Right.
Where you need footnotes and annotations to make sure that you realize, oh, we're
right. But it does seem like two areas of opportunity. One would be that to be able to net out the cost of goods from revenue. So, you know, if we're just collecting less revenue because it costs us less, that's fine, right? I mean, that's a, and then the second might be some way to summarize things of saying, here's the P&L. Here are the exceptions that are negative. Here are the exceptions that are positive. Here's the way you should think about it. I mean, some because the townhouse is going to be a monthly, you know, upside that we don't really want to consider, and there are a few other things, and the depreciation that hasn't happened yet. So maybe there's some simple way to that says the I'm okay sheet.
We did that a couple of for a couple of months in board presentation.
Right.
We did a slide where it showed where it netted out
right.
the interest expense and the and we had the depreciation netted out. And
yeah.
We're trying to just show if those aren't considered, how are we doing?
Right. And so I found that very helpful, and it's almost the place to start. So we could think about whether that's is something that's low overhead but could provide more immediate sense of where we are.
Sure.
Particularly if the planning committee is planning on upside. Let's make sure it's
that's right.
Planning on what?
Upside.
Right. Yeah, yeah. We're going to start.
I can tell we're doing better because there are cookies. The summer there were no cookies.
That's right. Okay, let's get us back. Go ahead, Kelly.
That is all I have on the October financials. Unless there are any further questions, I'll move on to November preliminaries. As you can see, revenues are, these are actuals for revenue. We had a really good November. Let's hope that continues. It was very cold in November. People were here for Thanksgiving. The resort was open, so we can see the effects of that, obviously. The rest of the expenses are obviously estimated. I did leave contract services because that is actually over budget, and it is due to that final invoice we got from Moss Adams being posted in November. And then moving on to just a few notes on the good November that we had. I did a slide here on metered kilowatt hours versus budgeted kilowatt hours. And you can see that for the year, we're doing pretty good, but November stands out as a really good month so far this year. And I think that that was something that Bob had asked in the past, if we could actually get that on the actual statements for PCS. It's not something that we can do in PCS, but we can do this very easily. I collect all that information anyway when we're doing rates, so
right.
It's really easy to put this up at the end of every month.
Yeah.
And then also, historically, this is our best November since we've had the electric fund. You can see that it's really, really good.
That's cool.
I thought so.
Yes.
moving on to the cash waterfall. Our November actual was 1.98 in operating cash, which was up from budget by $167,000. The increased November ARs have set us up for a good December. Last month, we were not going to meet budget when we had the December forecast, but with the good November that we've had, it's brought us back to being right on target with budget. December still looks to be our low point for this year, but being on budget is better, I think, than being below budget. So thanks to a good November. And our low point in the five-year budget is still quarter two of fiscal year 19. And this still does show the building of the switch station, which hopefully we won't have to do. And then updated reserve forecast. Obviously, we've mentioned the PG&E invoice not being received, so And that is all I have for financials.
What is the 105 about Valley expense to hit the reserve fund, 105,000?
Oh, that was the final payment to Q&D. That was our final payout to Q&D, not including that 18,000.
Okay.
That we're about to pay now. But.
And then you have $2.26 million.
That's the PG&E invoice.
Nancy, you have a question?
Yeah, so the cash waterfall says with the Russ low rollover. So I can't remember. Are we rolling over the loan?
We're using that as the default assumption, and the assumption we need the cash to finance the switch station.
Okay.
So that's kind of the worst case scenario.
Okay.
Which was our budgeting attitude up until good November. We shouldn't switch too quickly. But we're still assuming 5 years of drought and building a very expensive switch station.
That's all I have.
Okay, thank you. Should we move on to the Russ?
Yeah, sure, on that very subject, Nancy, the Finance Committee has been working with Randy Finken, Southwest Debt Management Strategy. Randy completed a review of the district's debt and suggested that the district look into refinancing several Russ loan draws, including the two that aren't included in the cash waterfall, to even out future repayment schedule and to take advantage of the current low interest rates. Russ loans can be refinanced at their maturity date without cost. However, if the refinance occurs before the maturity date, then the district would have to pay Russ the difference between the existing rate and the current market rate, either negative or positive. The board approved the refinancing of several Russ draws based on the approval of board members O'Grady and Epstein. An analysis was completed using several different projected interest rates. It was the consensus of the board members to delay on the refinancing due to the increased expense of the remaining term of the loans in question and the projected stability of long-term rates. And I just open this up to the Finance Committee Chair at the time.
All right, so the trade-off is if we refinance now for a 30-year, 35-year period, we could lock in a lower rate but more expensive than what we budgeted. So we would guarantee a rate increase of about 0.33 per kilowatt hour for doing that in order to cover it. But we would have some protection downstream. And the disadvantage of that is we would lose the ability to pay it off, assuming we had the cash, at lower rates. So it was our judgment that we're in a good cash position. And so to take away the opportunity to be able to lower rates wasn't really a great trade-off at this point in time. So that's why we decided that we didn't really feel that was a good use of debt service, if you will. But it did raise some other questions, which will come up in item F to rethink what our overall debt strategy is and document it. But at this point, we didn't see any real benefit of refinancing. Are there any questions? Okay, then why don't we move on to 8F, discussion and possible action regarding the district's investigation and to complete a rate study for all enterprise services. Thank you, Kelly.
Mm-hmm.
Thank you, John.
You may bring good news to any board meeting you wish.
I will try.
Michael.
Staff has been working on a rate study with the Finance Committee with the goal of standardizing the methodology of calculating base rate amongst the four major departments, electric, propane, water, and wastewater. Currently, water and wastewater use a usage factor to charge commercial base rates, commercial units additional base rates, while electric and propane use a single base rate for all accounts. District looking at this from three different angles, looking at it as a usage over the last 3 years to determine what a base rate or an EDU should be calculated on.
Included in your packet is a breakdown of propane usage, which shows EDUs calculated at 3,700 cubic feet, which I just came up with. The first unit, Mountain Club, currently pays one base rate for propane. Under this scenario, they would pay 43. There are 40 units in the Mountain Club, so that's kind of where I backward engineered that into that number. We plan to complete this for each service. Actually, we do have this information for each service, and we've been working with Bob Epstein on getting this information into a state where we could look at each one individually and see what their base rates are currently and what their base rate might be under different usage scenarios. The second area is costs. What costs should be covered by base rates and what should be covered by variable usage charges. And so we're looking at the costs to be broken down by fixed and variable categories. We've made some progress on that as far as what we feel a variable cost as far as if there is no snow or salary wages costs actually go down, but if there is snow, they go up for all of the different services. The goal is to determine which shop cost the district wants to charge for each as a base rate and a variable. And then the last area is to survey sister utilities to determine what their practices have been to ensure that we have a firm basis. Once the study is complete and run by, I'd like to run these results by rate consultant and legal counsel together to get their input before possible public hearings. My final note is that the Finance Committee meeting, a suggestion of having a special meeting to work on this subject was discussed. Currently, the idea would be to have a special board meeting on December 28th to discuss this, to discuss the rate study and other rate strategy issues. And with that, I turn it over to the president.
So as former chair of the Finance Committee, let me add a little bit more to this. So both, as Michael mentioned, both water and wastewater have the notion of equivalent dwelling units that fairly proportion out the base rate, but propane and electricity do not, so our smallest customer pays the same base rate as Chair 6, for example, and that's inconsistent with what we do with water and wastewater. So one purpose of this is to try to figure out if we're going to do an EDU basis for propane and electricity, what would those be? And so the report you're seeing there is an online tool that lets us rank usage totally, and then lets you go into detail and see for every month where did that usage come from. It lets us find if there's one month that was an exception. It might have been a billing error, it might have been a meter error, whatever, to be able to clean those out. So we have a very accurate reflection of what's going on. It also allowed us to verify that our bills are correct because we reverse engineer how much they're paying for an EDU and make sure that matches what we think they're paying. So that's been a useful tool. So that's one topic we want to cover. As Michael mentioned, the second is how much of our revenue should be in the base rate. The higher the base rate, unless with EDUs, there's a variety of trade-offs and we need to think about that. The one other thing that we had talked about that Michael didn't mention that I'd like to incorporated into this conversation is looking at our reserves and what our target reserves should be. I would like to include that if we have this special meeting, I would include that as well because some of our the general reserves you can only really get from property taxes. The special reserves are limited because one utility service can't subsidize another. That's not what we're trying to do. And that particularly applies to electricity. So what should our electricity reserves be? And I'm not really interested in having them be large and earning 0% interest. We have the opportunity to earn 5%. But once we decide to do that, the money can only be used to pay off debt, any debt service. It couldn't be used, for example, if we needed to put up a new pole because we lost one. So thinking through and coming up, sort of refining our strategy for reserves and cash usages. It seems like that would be a really good discussion. We had that about 2 years ago. And so I thought combining these three together and then holding a a special board meeting, assuming everyone's available, then the public could have a chance to look at this, and it would give us a chance to really, the analysis will be in very good shape. It's already in good shape, and I think it'd be superior shape, given another week or so. So we would, that would give us a target to have everything ready and get some initial feedback and discussion about direction, with the idea being that changes would probably occur through regular process and probably by the start of the next fiscal year. So that would give us, and the public, still another several more months to look at things. So that's the proposal.
Does the PUC impose any restrictions on applying the EDU formula to electricity?
Michael, do you want to?
Was it CPUC? Yeah. Not that I know of, Peter. We're not regulated by the CPUC except for safety issues, so I don't think they would.
That wouldn't be a restriction.
Your question would be whether the Energy Commission does regulate us and whether they would have any limitations on
what? Cal-ICE?
No, it's the California Energy Commission regulates public utilities. And the
I just know electricity and water. It's a whole different.
So we would ask Dick to verify if there's any limitation that we do. And then also we want to always conform with the purchase agreement.
Right. So one difference between the different kinds of things is that water and wastewater, are those always related to either a commercial unit, a place that's got a space, something that has space and people in the space and using the utility, a home, a store, a restaurant, whereas the electricity isn't. Electricity is sometimes just a piece of equipment that might be metered, right?
Yeah. Let's see if there's any comments from the public.
Are you planning to have kind of the objectives lined out?
Yeah.
For summarize.
Right. Right. Yeah, and the key questions is, should the EDU principle be applied to? Is there a reason why it shouldn't be applied to electricity and propane because they're so different? Or is that just something that we need to do? What should be in base rate? Those things. And it's not necessary that we would change anything immediately for water or wastewater. The more immediate question is really for propane and electricity, where we're not using the same methodology. And then having an overall cash strategy revision. So we would lay out the objectives for each, so kind of the trade-offs and the stuff's live so we could change it in real time and see what would happen. Questions from you? So is it the suggested date for the special board meeting would be 3:30 on Monday, December 28th. So I don't know.
It's okay for me.
Okay, so maybe you could get back to Michael fairly quickly.
Yeah, just dawned on me. It should be okay for me, but there's one thing I've got to check into, but it should be okay.
So if we can confirm the date, then we'll organize it around that. I apologize for missing the last 30 minutes of a great snow year.
Right.
That's good. Okay.
One question I have as I listen to you is whether this rate strategy, and it doesn't have to be answered today, but we might want to talk about it at the meeting, is whether this rate strategy topic ought to be in the Finance Committee's domain or at the Board's domain and outside of the Finance Committee for a couple of reasons. One, you're in charge of the data and not on the Finance, and the President, and you're not on the Finance Committee. So I'm not sure it should be considered by the Finance Committee separate from the Board, but maybe it should. And I just throw that out there for consideration, Eric, Bob,
yeah.
Michael.
And
do you understand where
the reason why we suggested that this first meeting with all the data together be a board meeting is to get the broadest possible feedback early on, and then it would really be in the Finance Committee's domain to work out the details.
Okay.
Now that was the thinking behind it. I think that concludes 8F, 8G. update and possible action regarding the recent outage of the district's Out Valley fiber line. Michael.
On Saturday, November 28th, PG&E informed the district that their telecommunications line with Cane Green was down. District staff verified that our equipment was also down, and recycling the power supply at the KM Green substation did not resolve the issue, which pointed to a physical problem. This is the same line that went down at the Silver Lake Bridge last winter, in March. With the recent bitter cold temperatures, it was 8 degrees below, minus 8 in Hope Valley on November 30th. We were very afraid that we had a similar ice problem. The fiber line provides the district's high-speed protection on the 34.5 line, remote relay capabilities, Cal ISO meter reading, video cameras, telephone, and it also provides PG&E with their monitoring. District staff at Edge were on scene on December 2nd. We were able to determine the break was 25 miles down the line from KM Blue and 3.1 miles from KM Green. They actually shoot a signal down to determine where that break is. And it turned out to be at the lower Bear River Reservoir Bridge. And you'll remember from Silver Lake, we're more susceptible to these problems when the line actually leads the 3-foot embedding to the trench, comes up, it goes across these bridges. You'll also remember that last year we went ahead and we sealed, we blew air through the spare lines that we had throughout, and we put caps on the spare lines so that they wouldn't become. And then we did not blow air through the existing conduit with the fiber in it in the, because we were afraid that we would actually, with the high pressures, we'd actually damage the fiber in the lines. On December 3rd, we were able to install a new line, 1,400 feet, in the spare conduit that we had. We actually had the foresight of having 3,500 foot of cable on hand, so any longest distance between bolts, we would be able to have another fiber installed. So we put in a new line, and Edge was able to complete the splices that evening. After recycling the power supply, two of the three lines are working. We have high-speed protection, which is the most important item. We have our cameras, our telephone, the Cal ISO meter connection is back, and we have remote relay control. The only thing that's still down is the PG&E telecommunication. They're monitoring SCADA. After recycling the power supply, it appears that the T1 car control equipment may be malfunctioning. We have ordered a replacement card that will be here on December 15th and notified Edge to be ready to return next week, that's scheduled for Thursday, to assist in the install and testing. We've also asked PG&E to be on hand remotely to be able to assist with the testing. We've also inspected our other bridge crossings to ensure that they have that we're sealed up and buttoned up. Edge did pull out the damaged cable, and the cable was not broken, but Edge does feel that the glass fibers inside were damaged due to icing up problems once again. The cable was initially very difficult to remove, which makes it appear that there may have been ice in the line that caused the problem. It is possible that water remaining in the conduit froze, or that water infiltrated the bridge conduit at the couplers, which I rather doubt. The conduit plugs were reinstalled after the repair. We are now researching the purchase of a reel of fiber as long as our longest span between vaults, which is 3,500 feet, to have that ability once again to go the longest distance and to replace what the fiber that we've already used. Additionally, we are working with Exponential and Edge to determine if there's any other preventative measures that can be taken. As I mentioned, the most likely cause of this damage is the ice that was left, or the water that was left over in the conduit line. And so I have a few pictures to show. This is the where we fell, the break was. This is the vault on the Bear Riverside that the seals were in place when we got there. There was water in the vault. That's what looks a fiber splice tray looks like. This is the district's fiber being loaded up to be used on site. And this is us assisting Edge on the repull of the new fiber, and you'll notice the tent that they used to make the splices and pulling the new line, which was completed. And with that, I open up to any questions or discussion.
Do you have any idea how often Volcano, I mean, I assume Volcano has more fiber lines than we have. I mean,
they don't have any bridge crossings. They don't go across Bear River, and they went through the Silver Lake area. They didn't go over, you know. So they don't have any bridge crossings. We did contact Steve Stone with Volcano during this, and they, you know, they were readily available to help us. They were very supportive, and we actually considered that we could use their spare lines and, you know, to temporarily hook up and go around our, if we had an issue where we couldn't pull a new line. But I don't think they have this issue, nor have we, except for the bridge crossings.
So how optimistic are you that we're going to figure out why this has happened 2 years running at bridge crossings and what we can do about it?
I'm very optimistic that we solved the issue. The one thing that we didn't do last year to prevent it, because we went through and sucked out all the water, is we didn't blow air through the existing fiber lines across the Bear River. And, you know, had we have done that, we'd have no problems at Silver Lake. So I'm optimistic that we found the two areas that were susceptible. But there was a decision made that we shouldn't blow out these lines. And in retrospect, I wish we would have given it a try, because obviously I think there was some water in there. Actually, when we pulled that vault and looked inside, the water line was above the cable line. So if we hadn't sealed it, it would obviously go into the,
yeah,
you know, do the same thing, raise up until it got to the freeze point and then froze.
Okay. Any other questions from Michael? Questions from the audience? Okay. Let's move on to item 8H, discussion and possible action regarding ongoing maintenance associated with the Out Valley Power Line project.
RCI has begun to work on the Caltrans claim. The board approved filing a claim for a cost not to exceed $5,300 for this $377,000 claim, which is related to the district having to realign the Out Valley power line into the roadway due to the snow pole installation safety concerns. The draft narrative and a list of supporting documents were provided by RCI recently and were forwarded to the board. District staff has a meeting set up with RCI for next week to put this into the right format. There's actually a form that we need to fill out with Caltrans. And it's our goal to have this submitted before the holiday season. And with that, I open up if there's any questions, or I'll move on.
No questions. Okay.
A recent FERC inspection pointed out that the district's transformer at the Cables Lake Dam, which serves the snowmaking operation, does not have spill containment for the 138 gallons of oil which it contains. This transformer, which was installed as part of the original special use permit with the Forest Service, sits on the floodplain of the Kirkus Lake spillway. District staff has held a preliminary meeting with U.S. Forest Service, who owns the property in question, on different containment measures which could be taken, including building a concrete moat, using a plastic product that you can actually bury and have a containment, kind of like a swimming pool issue, replacing the oil with a less toxic oil, or applying for a waiver with a spill containment control program in place. This investigation continues. I did want to bring it to the board. This is the transformer with our district meter above it, and that is an example of a concrete moat, which is a KMPUD. This is massive, of course. There's a lot of oil in this. This would be a very minor moat for 138 gallons, but that's what we're discussing with the Forest Service at this point.
Any questions? Okay.
Moving on, with the need for monthly access to KM Green, inspections of the Outvalley corridor and the recent fiber line issues, district staff certainly appreciates the board's decision to purchase a snowmobile. This has been taken out several times this year, and here is the snowmobile with the Expedition, loaded with a winch, chainsaws, snowshoes, everything you can imagine. When we go out there, we have the necessary tools to be able to do our inspections, because this is real remote territory. District has been able to keep up with our inspection module or program, which is really important when you think about liabilities and just being able to go out there and take a look at things. The district's line is in a remote area, and I don't know if you can see it, but the blue areas here indicate snowmobile trails that are maintained by the U.S. Forest Service. That's KM Green right there, right next to an established snowmobile trail. So when they have enough snow, which hopefully this is, we'll have easy access to KM Green through the snow. And we've been to KM Green on snowmobiles already this year, so it's feasible. This area here, which all remember is that side of the hill, doesn't get a lot of snow compared to this side, but this side takes a lot longer to get there. This area here in between is pretty rough, and that'd be difficult to get to the snowmobile until we get quite a bit more snow. And then the 115 is a different line altogether going down that hill. But we are lucky to have good access and a good relationship with the Forest Service. So I think we're real lucky on that. We have met with the U.S. Forest Service recently and confirmed our understanding of winter access on their trails and on their land. And you know, the different gates that go up when they close roads and the keys that we have to make sure that we have proper access. And I'll move on unless there's a question.
Michael, how long does it take to make that longer route over to Green?
45 minutes by car.
By snowmobile?
You can only go about 10 to 15 miles an hour, so I would say probably an hour and a half. So, but the other way is probably a half hour. So either way is long. But walking from Lower Bear River to KM Green is longer than that. I guarantee, because, moving on, we did it recently. Staff is in the planning stages for the 2016 United States Forest Service work plan. This plan documents the work this district plans to do in 2016 along the Outvalley corridor. Planned work includes the regrading of access and U.S. Forest Service roads as needed along the underground, along with installation of additional water bars, the small water bars to protect utility vaults from water intrusion. Revegetation is needed, removal of potential hazardous tree. We actually saw a tree or two that had died in our recent inspection, and the limbing of other trees that we also noticed. The plan is due early in the new year in order to get approvals in place prior to the summer. The plan is to have a draft before the board in January or February for comment. The district will be completing this in-house in a cost-saving move. Last time this was done by RCI, and we have recently met with the U.S. Forest Service for guidance and have completed an overhead inspection of this. So we're working on this, and we'll get this completed in this winter.
So you, I assume that's you.
That is me.
You walked the whole overhead?
We walked the 34.5 line. We were going to continue on down to 113, but we had the fiber problems.
How long did that take?
Hour and a half. Mm-hmm. At a brisk march. And it was snowshoe territory. So now it'd be probably long.
Okay. Any questions? 2016 plan. Okay. Moving on to 8I then, General update and possible action regarding meetings with PG&E and the planning phase of the potential switch station project.
District continues to pursue a discussion with PG&E on remaining issues with our interconnection agreement. As you know, the district is concerned with the cost of ownership charge for the substation work between Tiger Creek and Salt Springs, which was completed by PG&E on the district's behalf, and the cost and needs for the building of the switch station and alternatives to a construction, to this construction. The district has communicated these concerns and put forth a proposal to PG&E. PG&E has communicated that they received our communication and are having internal meetings to determine a direction and offer a counter proposal. We're hoping for a meeting with PG&E in the near future to discuss these issues. I think it is important to note that they have actually discussed a counter proposal, which I believe is good news. And then the secondly is that they have suspended all meetings and work on the switch station project, so we're not incurring any costs with regards to having weekly meetings and RCI and Exponential are not working on the design of the switch station project. So we're on hold with the project, and I think this is a positive step.
Any questions on the PG&E board? Okay, moving on. So item 8J, discussion of possible action regarding electric propane usage and meter billing issues at several locations, including the Mountain Club, Snowmaking Compressor, and Recreation Complex. Welcome, Brandy.
Thank you.
Okay. So starting with Mountain Club, as has been discussed at the last several board meetings, this was an agenda item in October, November, it was found that the junction blocks of the Mountain Club main meter had been placed into maintenance mode, not allowing proper reading of the electric usage. An estimate of the unmetered usage over the last 3 years amounted to approximately $80,000 charge. This was communicated to the Mountain Club board, and a billing system was set up to bill this over a 24-month period. Meeting with KPS, which is Kirkwood Property Services, representing the Mountain Club, was held, who stated that the Mountain Club has concerns and wanted to verify the problem, and that they would had not budgeted for this expense. They were going to write a letter detailing these concerns, which we have not yet received. So we will be contacting Kirkwood Property Services, the Mountain Club board again, and determining their, you know, what their concerns are and requesting that they put these in the writing so we can address those and bring these before the board. But at this time, I don't have a further update on Mountain Club. With that, I turn over to Brandy for the others.
Another meter that we've been looking at is the meter of on the transformer for Snowmaking Compressors. We had some wiring issues with that one, and we recently installed the load recorder on it, which I've recorded as a standalone alone meter that you can use in different locations to compare to your revenue meter. We think we have good meter reads for the remainder of this season, but we do plan to test the meter and the CTs in the spring once snowmaking is completed, just to make sure we don't have any slow meter issues there. As far as the rec center goes, we reported last time that this is actually a water issue, and the water use was misclassified as irrigation water. This has been communicated with the property manager, and the letter and the statement for this account is included in the packet for your review. And then lastly, the board had asked that we come up with a plan to check all of the commercial meters for accuracy. And we have put this plan into the supplemental packet that was sent around. And basically we have a four-step process. First, multipliers for billing system and wiring has been confirmed, and that was all outsourced as an Emerson project. Secondly, we're going to do manual meter reads on all of the meters, and that's going to be a recurring activity for us. We would like to read these meters every 6 months because our rules and regulations allow for billing of a customer for a meter that stopped working up to 6 months. So we want to make sure that we're getting in and actually reading these meters regularly. And then lastly, the CTs on each of our large revenue meters remain to be checked. So we have a two-step process that we plan to do here. And the first is to use the load recorder, which the district purchased, to do a comparison to see if we are within a reasonable range. And our rules and regulations state less than 5% is considered reasonable. If we see an issue when comparing this load recorder to the revenue meter, we can then do further testing on the CTs or the CTs and the meter. And depending on how many of these issues we come up with, we can either send individual CTs off to a testing company or we can have a company come out and test these in place. So I tried to put on our meter plan our priorities. Our priorities are going to be large usage customers that are only active in the winter. We'd like to get those done first if possible. And then we'll move on to the smaller users are the ones that are available year-round. And we have implemented this plan. We did do the manual read, and we actually came up with a couple of issues, believe it or not. We found some errors on three of our census meters that prevent an actual physical manual read from being taken. This is Chair 11, Red Cliffs Employee Housing, and the Pump House for snowmaking. Now, we've communicated with Census. We don't believe that these are problems as far as billing because we're still getting the remote reads. But the load recorder is in the transformer at Red Cliffs Employee Housing now, and these are going to be at the top of our list for things to look into as we go forward. So with that, I'll take any questions on our efforts to find and fix meter issues.
Any questions to the board? Go get them.
A couple of slides that share, of course, that's the junction block that we've talked about. That's the locking devices that we've talked about. And they have been installed on all the commercial units. You can see the, what they look like. You can definitely see if there's been tampering. And then there's the power log that we've also discussed.
Can I ask a question about those locks? Mm-hmm. Are they unique to the district?
They're numbered.
Everybody has their own social security number. Does the district have their own, ID, so to speak? In other words,
could someone fraudulently put one on that looks like?
I mean, in other words,
they're actually chronologically numbered.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, so
okay.
Then when you buy them, there's a 15784, and the next one, 856. So they're all numbered, and so we would know.
And we're recording those at each location when we install them, so we can go back and see if there's a random number that's somewhere it shouldn't be.
People are creative.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, so this is all done through Operations Committee. Do you have any additional comments you want to add?
No, we're just encouraging Brandy to keep on being detective.
Yeah, it's probably
going to be a continuing process.
Probably one of the more important things.
Yeah, definitely. And that's our priority, actually. Yeah. We discussed that when we were discussing our goals at our last committee meeting. And that's the top one, is to try to eliminate losses.
Okay. One quick question. So on commercial, does that include large multi-family buildings, which are residential, right?
Some of them do, such as the Mountain Club, the Lodge, some of those meters. The ones that are considered commercial for this are the ones that have the actual current transformers and leaves. So some of them, yes.
So once UCTs include residential?
Absolutely, because the wiring's much more complicated.
Right. Okay, good, thank you. We'll move on to item 8K, discussion, possible action regarding the district and Vail's ongoing efforts to resolve electronic harmonics.
Okay.
No update on this issue. Did want to keep it on the agenda as a pending issue. As previously discussed, district staff and Exponential Engineering have met with Vail Resorts engineers to determine the ways and means to correct the harmonics issues, which are produced by the chairlifts that exceed district standards. Staff will continue to work with Vail on a harmonics resolution plan, including the possibility of installing filters on chairs 4, 5, and 11, which is due by the first quarter of 2016.
What is that picture of?
Just chair 9. And snow. I guess it's more snow than chair 9.
I was looking for a harmonic distortion.
Okay, why don't we move on? Do you have any additional comments?
No.
Okay. Let me move on to 8L, discussion and possible action regarding the district's research and efforts to improve efficiency and minimize losses in each department.
I will start with electric on this topic. Our production and metered were up quite a bit for the month. We saw a total system loss, or unmetered, of 240,000 kilowatt hours. And looking back to last year, this is comparable to last December when the resort was open. So this is a 22% loss for the month. But what we did notice is that our out-valley losses remain stable this month. We've been seeing around 35,000 kilowatt hours lost to out-valley in that subtractive calculation that we do. But our distribution system losses were up quite a bit this month. And if we could take a look at the next slide. This is the loss per feeder for each of the months of this fiscal year. And I would like to point out that it does show that the lift feed is up quite a lot in November, which is the first month we were open. But as a note, we were not able to access chairs 3 and 4 to read them, so there is some usage probably there from maintenance early in the month that was not captured, but it's still up significantly for the month. So what we're doing is we're checking the feeder list again to make sure that we are accurate in comparing our build usage to our powerhouse relay data, and we're looking into historical data because we possibly can go back to last winter and pull the same information and see if we do see this sort of discrepancy in the lift feeder. We were surprised to see this, and we'll be looking into it more and keeping an eye on it for the upcoming months. If we move on to propane, again, we were up quite significantly because of the cold weather. We show a 2,500,000 cubic foots actual metered for the month with a loss of 130,000, which is 5% for the month. Year to date, we're at 4% and our goal is 2%. If we take a look at water, we show good results for November for water. We show an actual metered of 584,000 gallons for water. And if we take a look at the unidentified losses line at the bottom there, we have an unidentified loss of about 82,000 gallons or 12% for the month, which is 12% for the year, with our goal being 16. So we are pretty, pretty good on our tracking for water. And then lastly, wastewater as well had a good month. We showed an influent metered total of 730,000 gallons at the wastewater treatment plant. 584,000 gallons of that were metered. The unidentified use was 18% for the month, which brings us to 11% for the year with our goal of 30%. But again, we get a lot of infiltration in water or wastewater in the spring. So we expect to see that unmetered usage go up in the spring. And I would be happy to take any questions on performance reporting.
Okay.
question I have is, are those saucers still on order for the manhole?
They're still on order. We haven't received them yet. They had lost the order at the last board meeting. We're still waiting.
Is there any other vendors that produce those saucers?
No, but I'm worried. I have staff checking into it.
Might be worth checking out. It doesn't seem like they're eager to make a profit.
Or sell a product.
Yeah, exactly. So maybe we should. And we're eager to stop infiltration cheaply if we can.
Yes, sir.
I guess I'm still staggered by the 22% electric loss, number one. My only consolation is that I'd rather have that loss with Out Valley electricity at 6 cents a kilowatt hour or whatever it is versus, you know, whatever it used to cost to generate on diesel. About 22% just...
And Sanders, you know, I think that the answer here is the meter work. I think that
is the meter.
Is the meter, and there could be unauthorized usage. We did find some. Most of this is on the lift feeder, which isn't a huge feeder. It goes, you know, basically from, you know, the powerhouse to right out here, and that's it. So, Timber Creek sprung structures are actually on the lift feeder as well. So, where that that usage is coming from. I think the meters is our best option right now. Eventually, we could consider inline meters, which is an expensive proposition, which we looked at in the past. But it, you know, it's all about narrowing the focus of where this is coming from and where that usage is. I think it would be much worse if we hadn't done the improvements that we've been doing to the meters, as Peter mentioned.
Yeah, and given how that distribution system was built and maintained, I mean, I think my guess is that's where it is too.
So it's got to be close to 40 years old.
Yeah.
So the first chairs were put in the backside. That's the oldest direct burial.
And what the loss of the backside? We get an indication from Exponential that it's not a percentage, but still, you know, we just don't.
Okay, any other questions? Do you have any other comments?
No.
Okay, that completes item 8. Okay, we'll move on to item 9, General Manager's Report.
The Planning Committee has begun a dialogue with our county supervisors, Terry Woodrow, Alpine, and Lynn Morgan from Amador, about three important subjects: the specific plan mitigation measures, and how the district may be able to assist the counties by being the eyes and ears and collecting compliance records, employee housing, how the community can come together to fix a broken system and revise the current ordinance, and the fire department funding, how the counties might be able to assist in finding funding to help staff the fire department and allow for potential growth in the valley. Unfortunately, our meeting that was scheduled for this morning was canceled due to the weather, and will be rescheduled for January. A special note, the specific plan 10-year review has just come out, and this will be very important to this discussion. And so I open it up for any comments that might be before I move on.
Yeah, I'm really sorry to not be able to hold the meeting this morning, but actually with the 10-year review, it may be a more productive meeting in January. So we'll take it up on the Planning Committee as well as a 10-year review. I mean, I think the essential concern going in, and I haven't read the review, so it may not pan out, is that the proponent of the project, both hired and paid for, that it was appropriate that they pay for the consultant, but to hire them, really the county should have hired the consultant and controlled the report. So, who knows?
So does the county have to accept that report, or is just...
Yeah, it's a good question. I had the same question. I don't know if this is the kind of thing where, whether it has to be accepted, whether there's a process for accepting public comment, you know, like an EIR.
Right.
I don't know what that process is. It'd be good to know what it is.
Okay, should we move on to Russ Lescatchel?
Should the district have a visit from our RUS general field representative, Rodney Peach, on Wednesday this week? Staff was able to give Rodney a tour of the powerhouse and sections of the Outvalley line and show a slideshow documenting the construction of the Outvalley project. Overall, Rodney is very impressed with our project and what the district has done with their money and what we have accomplished. He offered to provide information on a high energy cost grant that the district may wish to pursue and provide additional information on the RUS cushion of credit, which I know is of particular interest to the Finance Committee. So it was a good meeting. I think it was very good for staff to put a name, a face with a voice, and make personal contact with him. So I'm glad he came up. He's scheduled to do an additional trip in the summer where you can see more of the line.
What is the high energy grant?
A high energy efficiency grant or high energy cost grant, it's for RUS members that have high utility bills. And the grant is for efficiency members to help, measures to help lower those bills. Whether it would apply to us, I don't know, but.
We use that grant to pay off some debt.
Yeah. Well,
that's the way I'd like to lower it.
The next issue is public utility district law requires public works bidding that every complete project for new construction or any sort of material supplies or labor which exceed $15,000 have to go through the competitive bidding process. And the bids must be based on adopted plans and specifications. The notice inviting bids must be published at least one time in a newspaper of general circulation. Bids must be opened publicly and inspected, and then the board must award those bids to the lowest responsible bidder. This works real well except in emergencies. And this is an area that I was concerned with, especially with the Butte Fire and then these fire rail lines. What if we had an emergency out in the field and it was over beyond these stated numbers? District staff discussed this with legal counsel, and that the delegation of an emergency public work contracting authority, there is an exception during an emergency, and this authority can be granted to the general manager. Public contract codes contains an exception for the normal competitive bidding requirements in an emergency by authorizing the district to grant that to a designated agency officer. You would need to do this by resolution or ordinance. This would have to be considered at a regular board meeting. If you chose to move forward with this, it would have to be a vote of 4/5 of the board rather than 3/5 of the board, which I found interesting. An emergency only is a sudden, unexpected occurrence that poses an imminent danger and requires immediate action. So, a down power line, something like that would pose in there. A general manager, or if I'm absent, the assistant manager can take these actions. The board must review this action within 14 days of the action taking place. And then you have to reaffirm it, and you have to the general manager must tell you why an emergency was in place, why this action had to be taken, and then you need to vote to determine whether we need to continue this action or not. There's a sample resolution in the packet. I plan to bring this back before the board, clean this up and bring it back before the board in January. But as has been our practice, I wanted to give you a chance to review this and think about it and let you know if you have any questions before it comes back before the board. I think it's a very prudent measure to take.
Thanks. Any discussion? Okay. Water conservation.
State is currently under 25% water conservation mandate and is considering extending this beyond the February 2016 expiration date. Right now, they're accepting public input. I'd like to mention that the Kirkwood community has been very committed in conserving water, reaching the 45% mark in 2015 as compared to 2013. So it's all in irrigation water, but we've done a good job. Hopefully, they don't expect us to draw 25% from 2015 numbers. We're getting about as dry as we can get.
But that probably includes 1.8 million gallons of construction, water used in construction.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yes.
That's why we'll listen to that. Yeah. Okay, I have to go to the next time.
Yeah, QED was also.
Yeah, that. So kind of had it passed.
And then the final item on the general manager's report is that the holiday party is scheduled for 6 o'clock with dinner at 6:40. And presentations, of course, and of course, the Secret Santa. So we look forward to seeing you all there. That concludes the general manager's report.
Okay. Any other questions?
I'll go water. I recall, though, that we didn't have a particular percentage that we had to drop. We just had to have measures in place and report what those measures were.
Yeah, small utilities, all we had to do is make sure that they only watered twice a week.
Yeah.
And I show those for information purposes. We did actually have to report on them. So that might change in the future.
Okay. We'll move on to item 10, operations report.
Yes, sir. Well, gratefully, the Kirkwood Volunteer Fire Department has received the Epic Promise Grant for 2016 for a summer festival. And also some support for the Labor Day 10K. I'll be working with Anna Schumann with Vail Resorts to define exactly what that grant means. In the committee's packet, you'll see it on page 108, and it's sort of vague on what it's, you know, donation of food and beverage, and I don't know if it's a monetary amount. Last year, they dedicated $10,000 toward that. I believe we went over it. They covered those costs. But I'll be working with Anna just to make sure that it's a similar offer that they're giving us, which I believe it is. And that's about all I have on that. We are planning to have a barbecue committee for summer festival committee meeting starting back up in January, so we look forward to having another successful event this year or next year. Moving along to our aquifer levels, this is a report that I normally give to the operations and capital committee. It's on page 115 in the committee's packet. For the month of November, well 4-5 was averaging around 181 feet above the pump, which is extremely good. Compared to last year, it was around 143 feet, so it's a 38-foot difference. And I count that to the way we're actually pumping the water and managing the water, plus the practices of, you know, not using as much this year for water reductions and conservation. Staff is continuing. We'll continue to monitor the aquifer levels, of course. And we recently also had an inspection this summer from Ken Hannigan with the State Water Resource Control Board. And in the packet on pages 117 and 118 is our response to her inspection report. But essentially, overall, the district is doing really well. Her concerns at the time were some of our water tank inspections and the process that we do that. And so staff has been providing the state with this information, and we probably look forward to doing more in-depth inspections next summer for our two water tanks. And unless there's any questions about our aquifer levels, I'll move on.
Okay.
Page 116 is the plant layout. Again, this is a report that I give to operations and capital and also occasionally bring to the board. We're in really good shape at the plant right now. The membranes are performing extremely well. We have one yellow this month, which is I believe it's aeration blower number 2. And it's working, but occasionally it'll fall down and staff has to go and fiddle with it a little bit. I'm hoping this is a simple maintenance issue where it might be a belt that's misaligned or or something simple, but we'll definitely keep an eye on it and bring it back to the board if there's more steps needed to make the repairs. Further, we also had an inspection from the State Water Resource Control Board on our wastewater side of the business, and we're working with them to respond to any issues and needs that they have. They were missing some data, and we've since provided it to them. But they also provided us, just recently on page 119, is a preparation for anticipated 2015-2016 El Nino rainy season notice, basically saying, get ready, if something happens, you prepare. Is all your water storage empty? Which, that's what we're doing, making sure all our emergency storage is empty, ready to go, that we have emergency sandbags that are in place that we can shore up things or prevent water from running through the front of the wastewater treatment plant and going into the basins, which has happened in the past. Staff will formally write up a response to the letter that we received just to let them know, hey, we're aware of it and we're going to stay on top of it. But again, I think overall the wastewater treatment side of the business is doing well, and I apologize that we don't have an update on the sausage, but we will follow up on that and see if we can find somebody else if we can't have this vendor come through for us. And then finally, I'd like to talk about the snow removal and side of the business. And gratefully, our operations staff has been very busy removing snow this winter. And I want to publicly announce that, you know, I just appreciate our district staff flexing from their normal day-to-day operation activities, whether it's wastewater, electric, propane, and just jumping into a trackless. This morning, they jumped in it. Some people were out there at 2 a.m. Most of the crew came in at 4. We had every piece of equipment we could throw at it working, and staff has been very flexible with their days off and trying to work with the district to make sure we provide excellent service for the community. With that, you know, there's always issues that come up with our equipment. Recently, the rams on the 924 essentially failed and also caused a problem with the dog ears, which is a piece of metal. Peter, help me with the description. Basically, it's a piece of metal that's attached to the ram that the pins slide into to hold the rams in place. And they became loose and kind of an oval pattern, so we were able to basically make some repairs to that piece of equipment to allow us to keep the 924 in operation. And it seems to be working out really well.
Greg was able to do that.
Yeah, he did a good job of that. I appreciate your advice and expertise on steering him to get that correction made. As Michael mentioned before, we have a new operator, a return seasonal employee, Nate Weber, who has been in machines for several years, and it's really nice to be able to put him out there and he knows exactly what to do and where to go and how to be efficient. And then the final two items I have for snow removal, we do have bamboo available for the community if you wanted to mark a path or your vehicle or something that you don't want us to hit. The bamboo's here, the district, it's $3 per stick, and just come to the, tell the community to come to the front desk, Kathy or Amy or Jess or somebody can help them out with that.
You might put that in the newsletter because I was unaware of that. Or even if you add it to the thing about soliciting committee members. If the board doesn't know about the community probably doesn't know about that.
That's a good idea. We'll make sure it's in there. And then finally, just again, we do have the emergency snow phone. The number is 209-256-9121. It's carried 24 hours a day, either by Joe or Dave. And so we're able to pick up the phone and address immediate needs, or you've got friends or family coming up and you notice that the parking path's not wide enough or you need extra help, just give us a call.
What was the number?
It's 209-256-9121.
It's usually carried during snow events, and then it transfers over to the main office to remain at the time.
I was able to find it very quickly on the website. Not a problem.
Yeah. That concludes my business manager's report, unless there's any questions from the board.
Any questions for it? All right. It's Nancy Taylor.
I went to throw my garbage away over Thanksgiving and today, and those handles are gone.
And so I have to leave the lid up. I'm too short to be able to grab it. So if there's any way to restore those handles, it'd be greatly appreciated. Otherwise, I'm one of your culprits who can't close that lid.
And you're talking about the secondary handles?
The handles that were on the handles, yes.
Okay. Yeah. ACES has, just so the board knows, they've got a brand new garbage truck, waste disposal truck. And when the operator, Rich, drops the load into the truck, the container is actually falling in deeper into the truck than it has before. And if you look at the sides, we just last week noticed some of the welded pieces that hold that handle together have sheared off. So we're going to have to re-weld those pins to the front and hopefully prevent that from happening. That's probably what happened to your handle. It's probably
the
one. Down the hill.
Landfill someplace.
Yeah, it's bears in the summer and birds, I guess, in the winter.
The other ravens.
Yeah.
And they look really healthy.
Oh, yeah.
And noisy.
Okay, thank you, Rick.
Yes, sir.
Move on for updates from the standing committee reports. Start with Standish on personnel.
We haven't met since the last meeting. Only finance.
Your report from month to month is remarkably consistent. Okay.
Your finance, I think, is the only one that met.
Oh, okay.
This week.
All right.
We don't have the name.
Oh, okay. Since it's from finance, we've really covered everything that was on our list. So that's good. All right, so moving on, as there for general discussion, opportunity for board members to ask questions, bring up topics. Does anybody have anything?
Go ahead, Jim. I have two. One, I'm struck by your PowerPoint presentation. I think they're great. I contrast them as I listen to this with the dog and pony show on the easels of yesteryear. It's much better. And my request is that you add up the box, if you would, both for this meeting, for the board meeting folder and box, both for this meeting and on an ongoing basis. I mean, I know you could probably finish in, a small amount of time before the meeting, so adding them afterwards, as far as I'm concerned, is fine. Is that okay with everybody?
Yeah, yeah. Be very helpful. Yeah. Or even 5 minutes before the meeting is going to.
Yeah, 5 minutes before.
Yeah, sure.
Although I think the second comment is, I think the box guru is Sandy, is that right?
I
would. That is absolutely correct.
Well, Michael always says it's Sandy. And I noticed you've added Jeff and deleted Bob Endy, which is great.
I didn't. I'm sorry, Bob Endy, yes.
Yeah. Could I ask you to go through the committees and just see if we've got the right people added? They might not be because they were invited but didn't accept. So, for example, in planning, Cheryl's not on there, and she's also not on wine and barbecue. But in finance, Mark Duvall and Casey Bland are not on there. I would have thought Mark would have, accepted. So if you could just, maybe I'll give you the names after the meeting.
And we'll ask them again if they
can. Yeah. Okay. And if we add new committee members, if you just add them to the right folder and people leave, but to delete. But like, Nancy is here accepting on planning, but she's a member of the wine and barbecue, it's not on that folder. I'll give you the list afterwards.
Okay, any other? Alright, so at this point we've completed the topics through 12, so we'll go into closed session for a discussion of performance reviews for all employees pursuant to GC 54957-6. And then after that, we'll return to open session. Thank you all for coming.